गुड मॉर्निंग सर, देयर एनी क्वेश्चंस? Okay, let's get started. So, are there any questions about what we were discussing yesterday? Okay. So basically looked at this design of the circuit for multiplication of unsigned digits is what we looked at. We are looking at the method that uses the carry save addition followed by the carry look ahead based addition. And this carry save addition basically does what is called the 3-to-2 sum and reduction. That's basically it takes a group of three sum ands and then performs the carry save addition to generate two sum ends. And we go through number of levels of this carry save addition, starting from n sum ends to sum ends. And when we have only two sum ends after k levels, where k is related to the n, then we perform the standard addition by using either carry look ahead based adder or carry look ahead based adder with higher level propagate and generate terms. And at the end of last class, we have seen the kind of changes that we have to make when you are dealing with the multiplication of signed integers, because the final partial product here is negative of the x multiplied by yn minus 1 to power n minus 1. We need to perform the 2's complement operation in order to get the negative value, and the 2's complement operation involves performing 1's complement operation and then adding 1 to the least significant bit, right? And so that requires 2 sum ends to represent the final partial product, right? So in case of the signed integers, there will be n plus 1 sum ends, and accordingly the number of levels of carry save addition may be slightly different from the case for the corresponding unsigned integers. Okay, but the method is exactly the same. Okay, and of course when you form these partial products, you have to remember that we have to do the sign bit extension, because all the partial products are of 2n bit length, right? And whenever you have a negative value, all the leading bits will be 1, and whenever you have positive value as a partial product, all the leading bits will be 0, right? So these are the differences that we have to bring in when we build the circuit for the signed integers, but the method is exactly same as that for the unsigned integers, right? And the timing analysis is also same. So I leave it as an exercise for you to design a circuit for the n equal 32, first for the unsigned integers and then for the signed integers, and then determine whether k is the same or k can be different, and then you check what is the time taken to perform the operation, then you could compare it with the delay for the combinational array multiplex circuit. Okay, yeah, are there any questions about this? Okay, I still see that attendance is only around 65 people. I request the class representatives to find out what is the reason for so many people skipping the classes. Yesterday's class also, many people have skipped. Nearly 20 people have skipped. And today's class also, about 20 people are not there. Okay. Please tell them that if they miss the classes, they'll find it difficult to follow. Okay, unless they bother to download the recordings and then go through the material, then understand by themselves. Okay. There is a lot of dependency on the topics that we cover at a particular point of time. To the topics that will be covered later. Okay. So I strongly advise that please don't skip the classes. Or even if you have to skip the classes, make sure that you download the material and then go through the material and then make sure that you understand the content of that. Okay. Yeah. So are there any questions about what we have discussed so far about the design of the multiplication circuits? Okay. I just want to make a mention that we are not going to cover one small topic related to this multiplication. One can reduce the number of initial summands to n by 2 by performing what is called Booth's recoding of the operands. I think it's the multiplier operand. Okay, it's covered in many of the textbooks, but it will take some time, so I don't want to spend time on that. Right. So basically, the Booth's recoding of the multiplier operand will help us to reduce the initial number of summands from n to n by 2. That will result in a lot of savings in terms of the number of carry save additions that we have to perform in the level 1 or level 0. And normally, when we use this Booth's recoding, then perform this carry save addition for a number of levels, and finally, we have this CLA based addition. It is referred to as what is called the Wallace tree multiplier. I'll just write the name here. Those who are interested can refer to any of the textbooks on computer organization, right? To go into more details. So the Wallace tree multiplier will include what is called the Booth's recoding. That will be helpful to reduce the number of initial summands from n to n by 2, right? Then the CSA-based addition, followed by the CLA-based addition. So all of these three parts put together is what is referred to as the Wallace tree multiplier. And more or less all the processors nowadays, they make use of this circuit, right, called the Wallace tree multiplier, for the signed integers as well as for the unsigned integers. Okay, so please refer to any textbook on computer organization like Hemmerscher's book or Stalin's book, right, to know the details of the Booth's recording. Okay, actually it may slightly increase the delay of the circuit, but it results in a significant savings in the hardware to be used. Okay, and that's the reason why all the processor manufacturers, right, or designers will use this Wallace tree multiplier. Okay, and we are not going to discuss the division operation again because it's a little involved, and those who are interested can refer to a book on computer architecture by John Hayes. That book gives the details of design of the circuit for division of the integers. Again, you will see that there is a separate circuit for division of the unsigned integers and another circuit for the division of the signed integers. And interestingly, one can design a combinational logic circuit for the division operations as well. As you would have seen, right, the whole of multiply circuit that we have designed so far uses only the gates, right? And it's also a combinational logic circuit, right? In a similar way, one can design a combinational logic circuit for the division operation as well. So the division operation will take two operands, then it performs the division and then returns the quotient as well as the remainder. Okay. So those who are interested can please refer to this book by John Hayes on computer architecture. You'll find some details there. Okay. It is not included in the syllabus, so that's the reason why we are skipping that part. Okay. Now we'll put all these different circuits together to build what is called the integer unit. That will be one of the major components in the
CPU, and typically the integer unit performs the arithmetic operations on the integer type data, and most of the integer units will also include the circuits to perform the logical operations, that is, you can perform the AND or exclusive OR operations on the gates, right? And typically any of these logical operations also can be carried out by giving the operands and specifying the operation to the what is called the integer unit. So integer unit will perform not only the arithmetic operations, but it also performs the logical operations. I'm just focusing on the discussion on the arithmetic operations. So the arithmetic operations can be addition, subtraction, multiplication, or the division, right? And as we have seen, the type of operands can be unsigned or signed integers. And the size of the operands will be n equal to 8 bits or 16 bits or 32 bits or 64 bits, depending on the declaration of variables, that is, whether it's a byte or a short integer or integer or something like the long integer or the double integer, right, for representing the 64-bit operands. So typically, if you have a higher-level language statement, and if you have the declaration like unsigned short integer for the variables w, x, y, z, right, then whenever you have a statement like y equal to w plus x, this statement will be represented in the form of an instruction of the processor, and that instruction will also have a representation. You'll study more about this in the computer organization course next semester. So this instruction will have all the details for performing the necessary operation corresponding to the higher level language statement. So what does this higher level language statement say here? It wants to perform the addition operation on the variables w and x, which are of type unsigned short integer, and assign the result to the destination operand y, right? So the information that we have is the operation to be carried out, right? So we have the first field here that specifies the operation, then the size of the operands. So in this case, it's short integer, so it's 16 bits, right? And then the source operand 1, source operand 2. So the information about the w will be put in one field, the information about x will be put in another field, and we also need the information about where the result has to be put, right? And that is the destination operand field. And there can be a few more fields. We'll come back to it when you study the next course, okay? And if you have a multiplication operation, let's say z equal to w multiplied by x, right? Then the operation is multiplication, and here the mul will represent the unsigned integer multiplication. Then again, the size is 16 bits. The operand information is also put here. Now we can see that the destination operand is specified as z. Now, instead of that, if you have another high-level language statement, simply with the declaration like int a, b, c, d, right? And if you have the statement like c equal to a minus b, right? So now the operation is subtract. Now the size of the operand is correspond to this integer, that is 32 int, right? Then the source operands are a and b, and the destination operand is c. And similarly, if I have the multiplication operation d equal to a multiplied by b, now we can see that because we are dealing with the signed integers, right? And we know that the operation to be performed for signed integer multiplication is different from that for the unsigned integer multiplication. That information is encoded in the form of a different kind of an operation here. So now we can see that we have imul, whereas earlier we have simply mul. Mul stands for the unsigned multiplication. Imul stands for the signed integer multiplication. Again, the operand size information is mentioned there, right? And the source operand information and the destination operand information. And all of this is to translate a higher level language statement into a machine level instruction. And machine level instruction will have different fields to specify the operation, the size of the operation, operands, then what are the operands themselves, then what is the destination operand. So all this information will be available as part of the representation of a machine level instruction, right? And that's what goes as input to the arithmetic and logic unit in general, or here we're talking about an integer unit, right? So what does this integer unit do? It takes the different fields in the representation of the instruction and then takes the necessary operations or performs the necessary operations, right? So it takes the operation information from the first field here, and that goes as the one of the inputs. Then it takes the size information available in the second field, that will also go as another input. Then it will take the information about the two source operands, so that will be operand 1 and operand 2. So all of this will form the inputs to the integer unit, and then it will perform the necessary operation of particular size on the two operands that are given, and it will use the corresponding circuit to perform the necessary operations, and then produces the result, and that result will be sent to the destination operand. I'm going to leave some of the details without explanation. What do you mean by sending the result to the destination operand? Again, we'll study that in the next level course. So what does this integer unit now contain? Because depending on the operation to be carried out and depending on the size of the operands to be carried out, right? Now we know that, right? The integer unit has to use the corresponding circuit to take the operands, source operands as input, and then perform that operation and then produce the result, okay? So typically the integer unit includes the circuits for addition or subtraction of integers. We have seen that we can use the same circuit to perform either addition or subtraction of either unsigned integers or the signed integers. Then there will be one circuit for multiplication of unsigned integers, multiplication for signed integers, right? And there will be one circuit for division of unsigned integers. There will be another circuit for the division of signed integers. And we also need to have the logic to detect the overflow conditions, either in addition or subtraction, or in the case of the multiplication. There is no overflow condition for the division, but there are some other errors that can occur in the case of the division. So that logic for detection of those errors will also be included in the circuits. And please remember that all the circuits are going to be there for every size of the operands, right? For n equal to 8, you will have all the circuits. For n equal to 16, there will be all the circuits, right? And so on. Because you can't use the same circuit to perform the operations for different sizes of the operands. So there will be proper logic in this integer unit, right? To send the input operand data to the corresponding circuit depending on the size of the operands and depending on the operation to be carried out, right? And then the output of that circuit will be passed on as the output of this whole integer unit, okay? So there'll be a lot of additional logic, right? Other than the circuits for the different operations and for the different sizes, all of that will be put together in the form of what is called the integer unit. At the highest level for us, right, the integer unit takes these inputs, right, and then generate the result. When I say the result, it can be including the result of the operation as well as any errors, right, like a overflow error, right? So all of that will be the output of the integer unit, and that will be taken, and then the further operations will be carried out in the CPU. Okay, so the integer unit itself will have multiple circuits, right, to perform the different arithmetic operations for the different sizes of the operands. Okay, and this is what I want you to make a note of, right? This is the reason why we have been going through a detailed discussion of designing the circuits for different arithmetic operations and for the different sizes of the operands and for the different types of integers, that's for the signed and the unsigned integers. Okay, yeah. Are there any questions? We are going to move to the next topic. So I just want to see if there are any questions about what we have discussed so far. Okay, it looks like, yeah. One second, can you show this starting point of today's notes? Okay, good, I'll do that. Yeah, is it this? Yeah, so have any questions about that?
Let me just check because I can't put both of them simultaneously. A little bit below, Sriram. Yeah, whenever you want to ask the questions, please unmute your mic and then ask. That's more convenient because I have to switch between the chat box and the notes otherwise.
Sir, like, can you show that part where you started
yeah.
to discuss about yeah. the integer circuits?
Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
Can you show a little bit below, like, where you started to discuss the integer? Integer?
This is the one?
Yes.
Okay.
A little bit.
Still. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, sir.
Is this fine?
Fine.
Actually,
sir, fine.
Yeah, I will upload the notes at the end of class today.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Fine. Yeah. Are there any other questions?
No, sir.
Not from necessarily you. I was asking other students also. Okay. All of you seem to be very nice people. Don't want to ask too many questions. Okay. Fine. Let's, if there are no other questions, let's move to the next topic. Sorry. Yeah, so far we have looked at how the integer data is represented and how we process the integer data to perform the different kinds of arithmetic operations. Okay. And now we'll move on to another important part of the CPU that deals with the processing of real valued numbers. And first we'll try to understand how these real value numbers are represented, right? And then we'll look into the details of circuits to be designed to perform the different arithmetic operations on these real value numbers. Again, it's possible that some of this discussion that I'm going to have now would have been covered in some of the earlier courses. Please tell me if that is the case so that I can try to skip many of the details. Okay, but I would like to go through that discussion so to make sure that all of you are familiar with the details of that. Okay, so when we looked at this integer data, when we had n bit integers, all right, we have seen that for the unsigned case, the range is from 0 to 2 power n minus 1, and the precision is 1. Right? What is the resolution or precision? The difference between two successive numbers that can be represented, or the magnitude of the difference. Right? And for the signed integers, which are represented in the 2's complement form, right, we've seen that it is minus 2 power n minus 1, 2 power n minus 1, minus 1. Right? So again, the resolution is only 1. And typically, the values of n that we use in the process are n equal to 8, 16, 32, 64 now in the current day process. So if you look at even n equal to 64, right, for the case of unsigned integers, it is 0 to 2 power 64 minus 1, right? And in the case of the signed integers, it is minus 2 power 63, 2 power 63 minus 1. And approximately what is this in powers of 10? You can verify that, right? So this will come to about minus 10 power 19 to plus 10 power 9, approximately. Okay? So as long as you're interested in processing the data that lies in this range of minus 10 power 19 to plus 10 power 19, you can use the integers type variables, right? And then perform the necessary operations. What does the 10 power 19 mean? You can have 19 decimal values in the number, So there are 19 positions, right, where you can have the decimal digits, right? And as long as the data that you want to process is less than this 10 power 19, right, you can use this integer type data, right? And that may be good enough for most of the applications, unless you're looking at some scientific applications where you may want to deal with even larger numbers, right? And whenever the data that you're dealing with exceeds 10 power 19, then you cannot use the integer type representation. And also we see that all these are whole numbers, so there are no fractions that can be represented, right? And again, for many scientific applications or for many other applications also, we see that we normally use the data that includes the integer part and the fraction part. And that's where we are talking about what is called the real valued numbers. Right? And typically, the real valued numbers will have what is called the integer part and the fraction part. So whenever you have some number like 37.75 in the decimal system, right? So this is the integer part and this is the fraction part. Right? So now we want to see how we can represent this kind of real values, right, where we'll have this integer part and the fraction part. Okay. Now the first question that's going to arise is, what is the range of values that you want to represent, right? And how many digits we can have in the fraction, right? Now, can you tell me, how does the resolution change depending on the number of digits in the fraction, right? Let's say if I have only two digits in the fraction, right? What will be the resolution in that case? So let's say if this is the number that I have currently, 37.75, what is the next number I can represent? It's 37.76, right? So what is the difference? It's 0.01, right? So you can see that it is actually 10 power minus 2. What is this 2 here? The number of positions I have in the fraction part. If I can allow one more digit in the fraction, right? Now the resolution will be 10 power minus 3, right? So now you can see that depending on the number of digits allowed to be there in the fraction part, right, the resolution will be different. And we need to decide how many digits we want to have it in the fraction part, right? And that will accordingly set the resolution with which we can represent the numbers. Suppose I have finite number of digits to be used to represent the whole real valued number, right? Let's say totally I have 10 digits, okay? Now, is there only a single way of making use of these 10 digits to represent these real values? I can have different sizes for the integer part and the fraction part, right? Let's say integer part and fraction part use 5 digits each. Right? What is the resolution in this case? 10 power minus 5. Can you tell me what is the range of numbers we can represent? Again, let's talk only the unsigned numbers here. Right? What is the smallest number that we can represent here? The integer part will be 0, and the fraction part will have 1 in the least significant digit position. What is the least significant digit position? What is the weight of these positions? On the left hand side, it is 10 power 0, then 10 power 1, to the left of the binary point or the integer part, right? So they write out the binary, I mean the decimal point, right? We have 10 power minus 1, 10 power minus 2, and 10 power minus 3. Right? If I have 5 digits in the fraction part, right? Then if I have 1 in the least significant digit position, right? You can check that the smallest number I can have is 10 power minus 5. What is the largest number I can have? That will be 999.9999. Right? How do we express this in powers of 10? Yeah, you can verify that. I just wanted to complete that. Can you write this as? Okay. Yeah. What is this value? It's a 10 power 5. Right? And what is this value? Power minus 5, right? So you can verify that this is 10 power minus 5 minus 10 power minus 5, right? So when I have 10 digits and if I decide to use 5 digits for the integer part and 5 digits for the fraction part, right, then the range of numbers is from 10 power minus 5 to 10 power 5 minus 10 power minus 5, and the resolution is 10 power minus 5. And if I decide to use these 10 digits to represent a larger range of numbers, right, then so let's say I call this as I and this I call it as F, right? So if I want to increase the range of values to represent, right, let's say I go for I equal to 8 and F equal to 2, then what is going to happen? The resolution is only 10 power minus 2, right, and the smallest number is 10 power minus 2 and the largest number is 10 power 8 minus 10 power minus. Right? So what is happening now? I can get a larger range of numbers, right? But the resolution that I have is going to be poorer because anything smaller than 10 power minus 2 resolution, I cannot have. Or if I decide to go for I equal to 3 and F equal to 7, right? Now you can see that I can have a better resolution of 10 power minus 7, and the range of values is going to be 10 power minus 7 to only 10 power 3 minus 10 power minus 7. Okay, so now there is a trade-off here, right? Whether you want a larger range of numbers or you want a better resolution. What do you mean by better resolution? I should be able to represent numbers with smaller fractions. When I say smaller fractions, more number of digits in the fraction part, right? So now it's a kind of a trade-off between the range of values or the precision or the resolution with which we can represent the numbers, okay? And whenever we use this kind of a method, right, we refer to this kind of representation of real numbers as the fixed point representation. Why is this called as a fixed point representation? We are deciding the position of the decimal point, right? So the decimal point can have, our decimal point can be such that there are 5 digits to the left and 5 digits to the right, or there are 8 digits to the left or and 2 digits to the right, or 3 digits to the left and 7 digits to the right, right? And once you fix the position of the decimal point, right, then for that fixed point representation in general, right, for I and F, now you can see that the resolution is 10 power minus F, right, and the range is right? 10 power I minus 10 power minus F, right? Now, can we extend this discussion to the binary system? If I have n bits totally to represent the real values, right? And if I decide to use I bits for the fraction, sorry, I bits for the integer part, and F bits for the fraction part, right? And because we are talking about the binary representation, the base is going to be 2. So what will be the resolution? Again, I'm talking about only unsigned values, right? So now it's going to be 2 power minus F. And what will be the range? 2 power minus F to 2 power I minus 2 power minus F. Right? So now, what does this mean? If I have something like a bit sequence like this, right? To the left, I have 4, right? To the right, I have 4 bits, right? So totally n is equal to 8, right? I equal to 4 and f equal to 4, right? And the resolution for this is 2 power minus 4, right? And the range of values is 2 power minus 4, 2, 2 power 4 minus 2 power minus 4. Right, and what is the weight of each of the positions here? So this will have weight of 2 power minus 1, this will have weight of 2 power minus 2, and so on. Right, to the left of the binary point, it will be 2 power 0, 2 power 1, right, and so on. Right, so again, we can have the n-bit representation of the real values, but we need to decide how many bits will be used for the integer part and how many bits will be used for the fraction part. And again, depending on values of I and F, the resolutions will be different and the range of values can be different. Now, let's say n is equal to 64, just for the sake of discussion. And I decide to use I equal to 20, right? And F equal to 44, right? Yeah. What is the resolution going to be? 2 power minus 44. Right, and this is going to be, sorry, range is 2 power minus 44, 2, okay. What is 2 power 20 approximately? We know that it's approximately 10 power 6, right, and accordingly you can check that. Right, this is going to be approximately 10 power minus 30. So 2 power minus 44 is 10 power minus 13, right? And 2 power 20 is approximately 10 power 6, right? So what is happening now? Even if I use 64 bits, right, I can represent the values only from 10 power minus 13, that is 13 decimal digits in the fraction part, integer part, which is not good enough for many of the problems or many of the applications that we want in, right? I just wanted to compare this range of values to the range of values for the unsigned integers for n equals 64, right? We've seen that there it is, 0 to 2 power 64 minus 1, right? That's approximately 10 power 20, okay? So if you go for the integer representation, you can go up to 10 power 20, that is 20 decimal digits, right? Whereas if you use the fixed point representation of n equals 64 with 20 bits for the integer part and 44 bits for the fraction part, the range of values gets reduced significantly down to 10 power 6, right? And of course, on the fraction side, you can go up to 10 power minus 13. And the resolution is also 10 power minus 13, right? So you can have a better resolution or a better precision but the range of values gets significantly reduced, right? So that's not good enough. So even if I can use 64 bits, right, the range that I can afford to have is small. And if I increase I to a larger value, let's say 30 or 32, right, the range will increase, but that will affect the resolution. That is, the smallest fraction that I can represent will be much smaller, right? And that again will be, now when I say smaller, it will be a smaller number of decimal digits in the fraction. Again, that will not be adequate for many of the problems. So the fixed point representation is not a good solution, because for many scientific applications, we want a very large range of numbers, and we also want to be in a position to represent the numbers with large number of digits in the fraction plot, right? And that's where we go into a different type of representation, where we don't fix the position of the binary point a priori, saying that out of total number of bits, this is the number of bits that will be there to the left of the binary point, and this is the number of bits that will be there to the right of the binary point, right? We allow that position of the binary point to vary depending on the values that we are dealing with, right? That's what is referred to as the floating point representation. Okay, as we'll be seeing later, right? The floating point representation allows us to go for much wider range of values than what the fixed point representation can give. And then depending on the numbers that you're dealing with, the resolution will also be better, right? But interestingly, as we've seen later, right, the resolution will vary depending on the numbers that you're dealing with, whereas in the integers, as well as for the fixed point representation, right, the resolution is fixed. In the case of the integers, the resolution is 0, that is 1, right? In the case of the fixed point representation, it is 2 power minus f. I'm talking about unsigned integers, right? And we'll be seeing that resolution is going to be varying, right, even for a particular type of floating point representation. We'll wait until we go through the discussion. Before we go into the floating point representation of the binary numbers, right, let's look at a simple example, right, for the decimal system. Suppose I have a number like 325.178. This is, let's say, the value of some variable x. Is there only single way of representing this value, right? Actually, this is, when you say this, right, this is 325.178 multiplied by 10 power 0, right? Can I write the same value as 32.5178 into 10 power 1? Do we see that the value is the same, right? But I have a different way of representing that value, right? Or I can shift this decimal point even to the left by one more position, right? And then say that it's 3.25178, right, into 10 power 2. Then say it is 0.325178 to 10 power 3. Okay? And it's not to say that you have to shift the decimal point only to the left. You can also shift the decimal point to the right, right? Now, it will be multiplied by 10 power minus 1, or if I shift that by another one digit position, right? So now we see that the same value can be represented in different ways, right? And this kind of a notation is what is referred to as the scientific notation. Right? And it is also referred to as the exponent mantissa form, right? What is the exponent here? Whatever is there in the power of 10 here, right, is the exponent, right? And whatever is there here, right, is what is referred to as the mantissa, right? So that now instead of representing the number, real valid number, in the form of integer part and the fraction part, right, now we want to represent the information about the value of the number in terms of the mantissa and the exponent. So now we need to have a mechanism to represent the exponent and a mechanism to represent the mantissa, right? Again, please note that the exponent can be positive or negative, and the mantissa also can be positive or negative, because if x is negative, right, the mantissa will be negative as well. So in order to represent this value of x, we need to represent the exponent and we need to represent the mantissa. Now we can see that there is no unique way of representing a number even in the exponent to mantissa form, right? So that will make it very difficult when you implement the process and when you want to port the data from one system to another system, if the different systems use different number of digits for the exponent field and the different number of digits for the mantissa field, right? And if the position of the decimal point is not fixed, right, then the portability of the data from one system to another system is not going to be possible, right? That will complicate the matters. Representation of these real values in the exponent mantissa form, right? Now we introduce what is called the normalized representation, right? And what is the meaning of the normalized representation? The accepted definition of this normalized representation for the decimal number systems is that there is only one non-zero digit to the left of the decimal point, right? So what is the normalized representation of this decimal point? This is the, normalized representation of this value of x, right? We see that in this form, there is only one digit to the left of the decimal point, right? And this corresponds to the normalized representation. Right? So now it's very clear that whenever I use the normalized representation, there is only one non-zero digit to the left of the decimal point, right? And there can be some number of digits to the right of the decimal point, right? And the exponent is also uniquely specified for that number, right? Suppose I have x equal to 0.072. This is not in the normalized form, right? So what is the normalized form for this? I have to shift the decimal point to the right by two positions, right? So that it becomes 7.2, but the value should not change, right? So accordingly, we have to decrease the exponent, right? So now 7.2 multiplied by 10 power minus 2 is the normalized representation of the value 0.072, right? So now we take the mantissa field of this representation and also the exponent field of this representation, right? And then represent this mantissa and exponent fields, right, to specify the number. In case x happens to be negative value, right, the mantissa will also be negative value, okay? Now we can see that there is a unique way of representing any real value
right, in the normalized form, right? Only thing is, we have to specify still what will be the length of the matrix of field, right? And what will be the length of the exponent field, okay? Are there any questions about this? So basically, I wanted to understand how the real values, real value numbers do get represented, right? In the fixed point form is what we have seen a little earlier, right? And how they get represented in the scientific notation form, that is the exponent matrix form. And we are looking at what is called this normalized representation of the real values, where the normal representation will be only one decimal digit to the left of the decimal point. We are discussing all of this for the decimal system. We'll quickly look at it for the binary system, right? Maybe in the next class. Yeah. Are there any questions? Okay, maybe I think there are no questions. We'll stop at this point. Okay, and we'll continue the discussion where we'll start looking at the floating point form representation for the binary numbers, right? And then we'll look at some standards that are used to represent the real values in the computer systems. Okay, yeah. Okay, there are no other questions. Maybe we'll stop here. Yeah, I will upload the notes here. Yeah, immediately after class, I will upload. Okay, any other points? Okay, then bye, see you then on Monday.